which are factual pieces of information, their dates, their years, their names. And then you've also, in fact, we talked about it last week on the memory unit, you've also learned about procedural knowledge, which is when we put things together in a sequence of how to do something. And so these pieces all have to do with metacognition, because what we know about metacognition, as we mentioned a minute ago, it's knowledge about how you process information, it's knowledge about how you think. I'll give you a quick example. Most people have a different definition, well, I'm sorry, have a different preference for a class that they prefer. Some people love math classes, some people love English classes, and some people dislike math classes. We develop what are called metacognitive abilities based on experience, obviously, because that's the third of the procedural knowledge, but our depth of ability to process and use different strategies for those subjects changes. So metacognitive awareness isn't just this domain general area. It does require both declarative and procedural knowledge, as well as your ability to regulate your processes. And by self-regulation, as we talked about in classroom management class, if you're in that class, the self-regulatory abilities look fundamentally at planning, in other words, goal setting, monitoring, in terms of your ability to, for example, reading, you can monitor how quickly or how slowly you read. And last is evaluation, so it's planning, monitoring, evaluation, and evaluations where, for example, if you're reading, I love using reading as an example, because when you're reading a book and you read really quickly, there's an internal mechanism that lets you know that you are reading too fast, and so you see stop. You can go back and review, and we can regulate our processes. All of these are metacognitive abilities. Let's say we have a phone call, which is great. You know, I love speaking to you, so I don't get lonely. So we have Pablo calling from Long Beach. Hi, Pablo.
Hi, Victor. Hey, I have a question. It happened to my grandfather. He used to study nuclear physics in Leningrad. And in order to get his doctorate, he had to solve a nuclear physics equation. He took for him, like, it was like trying to solve it like for a week. And then one night he woke up in the middle of the night and he solved it. He solved the whole equation and he received a silver medal because of that. And he got his doctorate. My question is that simulation, this time away from his brain, this frame of time between when he went to sleep and then when he woke up, is that, would you call this simulation in the creativity process?
Well, thank you for calling. I don't know if they call it incubation of the creativity process. You know, obviously, with just that information, but it's a good question, Pablo. You know, I guess part of it is that if you're working on getting, I think you said that you're working on getting a doctorate degree, so you obviously have developed some form of expertise in the area with which you're studying. The only question I would have, and I'm sure grandfather, I don't know if you got to this level of question with them, is generally when you're going to give a question out to get a doctorate, it's something that really can't be solved in just a week. It's something that would require a couple of years to solve. So my sense is that I go back to the memory because it being something that was so familiar to something that he already learned that when he was sleeping or unconscious, different pieces, we talked about spreading activation last week, maybe different pieces just came not connected and came up with the answer. I don't know. We're going to get into creativity in the second half of the class tonight, and we're going to look at it from a couple of different dimensions. But that's was an interesting story that I can say. So let me just to refresh what we were talking about a moment ago. We talked about what the definition of metacognition is, which really is learning about learning. It's about knowing about how we think and knowing about our learning processes. What I'm going to share with you now is I'm going to share with you a very quick video. It's only 4 minutes long. And it's a wonderful video on metacognition. And I think it's going to help set the table to talk about some of the different questions that Amy brought up in an email. So let's watch this video and we'll come back in about 4 minutes. For kids. And part of it is that a lot of the things that we get when we talk about metacognition, we talk about what's called a metacognitive awareness, is that it's important to start asking kids about what they're thinking. So the fun part about metacognition is that we start to get away from the one right answer mentality, which is medieval. It's fairly destructive. But the other piece is that very rarely are kids asked about what they're thinking about. And so I think that becomes a huge piece. One of the comments that I wrote down when I watched that video again was that you get to understand what you're trying to teach them. And I think that, I do a lot of things that I hear from teachers regularly is that we have a lot of pacing plans. And the pacing plans, they force you, for example, all elementary school teachers, they force elementary school teachers away from teaching science and social studies because they're so fixated on teaching the open core, the English language arts, and then the math, whether it's a Scott Forstmann math or whatever the math program is that you have. And so I think that when we're looking at why we talk about metacognitive awareness, or why we talk about developing disability in kids, the important piece is to remember that one way to find this out is to ask them. However, within that, metacognition is not this thing that you either have or you don't have. It's certainly like many things, like intelligence, like creativity. on a spectrum, and you have kids that have high metacognitive abilities or with an autism that's high metacognitive awareness, and then you have children that that are not so metacognitive and have to struggle with these pieces. One of the things that the theories seem to suggest is that differences in metacognitive abilities may have something to do with development, may have to do with something with cognitive development, may have something with social development, may have something with emotional development. A lot of the pieces that users don't necessarily understand is that this, I talked about this again in the class recently, which is a lot of times when we communicate in schools, the communication pattern is horizontal. In other words, we have grade level meetings, and we don't get to see the curriculum or experience the curriculum from a verbal perspective. We don't get to talk to people in the grade levels above or below us. You see this especially in elementary schools, which is really quite terrifying because this is really the time period that metacognition can explode. The research that I finally get back to Amy Jasper's question, the theory seems to say that people begin to develop metacognitive skills around first grade, ages 5 to 7. So it's those experiences where we start getting kids to start looking and thinking about how they interact with learning materials. Is where it's important to get away from just the rote drill and fill pieces, which I know is a tremendous frustration to a lot of teachers because it's almost pushed on them to do this thing called teach to the test. But it's important to know that you can teach to the test and simultaneously teach metacognitive abilities. So as we're talking about differences, I think that's one piece to look at. And I see, you know, again, one of the problems with teachers, I wasn't going to let you wait on hold if you called in. We have Maria calling from Long Beach. Hi, Maria.
Hi, good afternoon, Professor. I'm from Long Beach, but right now I'm at college watching your show. I have a question. Can you hear me?
I can hear you. I heard that you're in Alabama, Charles.
Okay. I have a question regarding metacognition and what can you say about if I'm teaching math, especially algebra, like how to find the square of a number, it has a lot of steps before you come up to a particular solution. And then there's step 1 up to 10, or there's another strategy method. How would you say that students can memorize the steps? You know, is memorization part of metacognition, or do they have to really understand the steps before they can memorize, or memorize vice versa, memorize the steps before they can understand the steps in solving that particular math problem?
Metacognition. I think that what you're talking about is, when you're talking about memorization, you're talking about memorizing steps. I think one thing to think about is that when you're looking at metacognitive abilities, metacognitive awareness, it's knowing, on one level, it's knowing that there are steps required to answer a question. However, when you're looking at the memorization of rote learning, that's more of a learning strategy. For example, there's a different way to study for a true false test, and a different way to study for an essay test, and there's a different way to study for a math word problem and a math non word problem. All of those different pieces of information, all those different study strategies, go into this pool of, if you want to think about it, of metacognitive awareness or metacognitive abilities. And so your metacognition deals with how you understand about your learning processes, and how you know about your thinking processes. I don't know if that specifically answers your question, but I think it should come close. What else can you ask as a follow-up?
Yeah. Are you telling me memorization is not part of metacognition? Is that what it is?
No, what I saying is that metacognition is concerned about how you learn, and one of the things that we know when we look at things is that sometimes we know from looking at things that we have to memorize. I'll give you an example. A little bit later, we're going to talk about mnemonics. We briefly touched on last week. We're going to touch on one specific mnemonic that has to do with problem solving. But there's certain things that we memorize. For example, I memorize Roy G. Biv. And I know, because I know several ways on how I learned that mnemonics can work for me. It's the same reason why my kids know that if they see something that maybe they can turn into a song, that strategy will work. Knowing that you have a strategy available to you is an example of metacognitive ability. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay.
Now I get
it. Well, enjoy Malibu, and thank you for calling. So let's go over the questions that we have. I see that Matthew, and well, I'm assuming that's Matthew Baxter, says that the chapter introduces itself by saying that metacognition is a philosophical orientation. Yeah, probably. Does that mean that a lot of the ideas discussed on this topic are conjectural? I ask, since in this era where data must inform pedagogical choices, is using this framework terrible? Correction, I think it goes down below. Correction, the cognitive perspective, not metacognition, it's a philosophical perspective. I don't think I got lost somewhere in the question, but I don't know. I don't know if I would disagree with the fact that metacognition is a philosophical perspective, because it has to do with knowing about how we process information. This is my full your question. I think that if it's informing pedagogical sources, is that a viable solution? But it's not necessarily a solution. As you can teach metacognitive skills by putting kids in situations where they have to reflect on their learning. And so as we go through this, I actually think that as we go in this next video that's going to look at the research on metacognition, I actually think that the video is going to answer part of that question. But before we jump into that video, let me get a little statement here, because it's related. It says, I think that with math, metacognition is to understand why the step is done, not memorization. I think that math metacognition is to understand why the step is done, not memorization. I think that you're probably right. I think that it's sort of a conglomeration of skills. So let's do this. The next thing I'm going to show you has to do with research-based studies. So we have a couple of different professors that are discussing this through a variety of different mediums. And I think that you should enjoy this video. And then we're going to debrief the video when we get back. So it's time to make
is So one thing that we wanted to incorporate into this research process is to make sure that kids are motivated to participate. We have this type of video game set up with a put the specific experiment within the theory. Here's an example of one experiment that we've been running. It's we call it Dragon Master Game.
Dragon Master.
You can tell from the kids that they love doing this because it's a game.
So I think that that's a little bit of a comparison between kids roughly the age where we're talking about the really good games, about here about the kids being developing the skills from age 5 to 7. So all that huge piece of development skills has to do with the environment. And we had a phone call from right before we went to the video clip. So let's take Mike calling from Palfrey. Is that Mike?
Can you hear me okay?
I can hear you.
Okay, good. Hey, listen, I'm running a kind of odd situation. I just want to get your opinion here. I have in teaching now, several of the kids are very creative, and I find that they get distracted quite easily in class. And I'm just wondering, you know, what kind of thinking or where should I be looking to kind of keep them engaged as well as the other kids?
Well, friends, when you say they're creative, how so?
Well, they're artistic, you know, they like to draw, and they take art classes, and you can see that they're probably going to go into drama and so on. So, and other kids aren't quite as, they're more focused on what they're studying and so on, and I just see some divergence there that in teaching it really creates a bit of a challenge.
Is this just high for it?
Right.
Yeah, I think I wonder if those that are heading towards the art drama way, have they verbalized their their career or their college aspirations in terms of going down the art drama path, and also my second part of the question is, what's the size of your future? Is this a business related course?
It's a business related course, right, and also math.
And
so math, I need to have, you know, focus and attention, and I find that the creative kids are, and you know, I mean, they come in and they've got, you know, purple and orange and yellow clothes on, and other kids don't wear that, so, you know, because they're in drama and different things, and, you know, they have quite a bit of flair going on, so, but when I ask them to start working on things, I find that they have a hard time focusing on, you know, say, a structured type of thing like math.
Well,
bounce it off and see if you have some ideas.
Well, do you know where they're, what they're looking to do after high school? Are they looking at going to drama programs, art programs, college? Or?
Well, I'm going to assume that they, just based on discussions, that they are heading towards a, you know, career in, or careers in more artistic fields, because they express that, and, you know, they feel comfortable expressing themselves that way.
I think part of it may be that sort of a disconnect between their, you know, the things that I'd be curious for, which is part of the safety science stuff, would be comparing their behavior in those classes where they tend to have higher interest, if that is their interest. I mean, maybe they used to be attempting to be different because of, you know, we have an identity formation stuff, but I'd be curious to see what their behavior is like in other classes.
Towards that as well, but I just seem to get distracted a lot quicker than the other kids do. So.
Yeah, that could be a variety of factors. I don't know, I'll follow up with you on that. I've got emails from you regularly, so we can keep that conversation going.
Good.
But thank you for calling up. And it's nice to hear your voice. So as we go through this, a lot of this stuff has to do with, that's a classic example. I mean, it's not just, you know, the art kids that come in with different hairstyles. It's any time that you, and again, that's some of the pieces that you might have heard of. One was business, two was math. A lot of kids in high school may not understand the relevance of these courses. I know a lot of you that have taught the junior achievement piece this semester have reported back unbelievably favorable responses to this. Some of the conversations I've had in the last couple of weeks have been really wonderful. Just to hear you say things, and they go in and they apply. I think one of my former students, Derek, was telling me that some of these kids actually told him that they were going to apologize to their parents for wasting so much money. Because, you know, kids don't see the relevance, which is why when you put them into a situation like a finance park with junior achievement, they took the ability to look at the existence of that in a classic, in a nutshell, as problem-based learning. You know, here's your life situation, you go figure out what you're going to do, and get to problem with something later. But I think that what you're looking at are relatability and engaging kids and getting kids to think about learning. I think part of it is getting them to get over their stereotypes about classes like business and or math, just because they're 17 or 16, and they don't see the relation. And I think that I applaud Mike in the fact that that he's asking these questions. How do you reach these kids? Because it's frustrating to know that you're out there doing a good job, and yet you have a couple of kids that no matter what you do, seem disinterested. That's one of the unfortunate pieces of this business. JEDS has a question here before I transition back to sort of debriefing here from the video that you just saw a few minutes ago. Well, he says, how can you as a teacher incorporate metacognition when assessing with students? And if I understand your question correctly, what you're asking is, do you include metacognition in your grading scheme? In other words, do you use their ability to use their knowledge about their learning as an assessment tool? I would say that it's probably tough to assess metacognition, but over time you certainly can watch it grow, and you can put kids in situations where what they have to do is reflect, and I guess that would be the way I would say that you would assess, but I don't like using the word assess in this situation. I would probably say that the better word would be measure or gather information about. Is to ask them to reflect on what they thought about a project, what think about writing papers, where do you see the great challenge? And one of the things I used to do when I would give out tests is I would put different boxes in the corners of some of these tests. And in various ones, I would tell the kids that I want people to mark your mood, draw a face, a happy face, a sad face, a confused face, or whatever, at various points in the test. And then while they were doing it first, and then they got done with the test, and I would grade the test, and we get back the test, what their next assignment was to go back and see if they could remember what they were thinking about the test at that present time. So you start talking about how your perspective of the test changed throughout the test. Very few kids put happy faces all the way throughout. I don't know if you want to do these things, those kinds of activities. They're great ways to get kids to start reflecting on what they're learning. That's, that's obviously of huge importance. Based on the clip that I wanted to make sure that you really took back was when one of the professors was talking about kids making judgments about learning. That's another piece. To metacognition, that's important. We talk about knowing about learning. We talk about learning about learning. And we talked about knowing about learning. I forgot the third one that we're talking about. But the piece that they talk about in that video has to do with making judgments, which if you go back to the Bloom's taxonomy work, making judgments is evaluation, which is the highest order level of Bloom's taxonomy. And so it's very important to start getting kids to start looking at metacognitive awareness, because what you do is you start to get to engage them in these deeper levels of processing, the higher order thinking skills. So they are good. And while you may not necessarily be appropriate in first grade or in kindergarten, we certainly did see a child get frustrated and stop and ask them, are you okay? What's making you upset? And get them to start verbalizing stuff. You don't have to go into a lecture with a 4-year-old or a 5-year-old. I'm just trying to build up your metacognitive awareness here. But what you certainly can do is talk to them, start planting that seed. That seed, if you will, about metacognition, so they start to think about how they're going through processes now. When we talk about learning stress, we're talking about building these things up with children. This is kind of to address Mike's question a few minutes ago, which is what we know is that for kids to learn, one of the things that we know is that they have to be engaged, they have to be cognitively engaged. We're going to talk about this in 2 weeks, I think, or 3 weeks, I guess. Then we get to the motivation chapter, because it has to do with choice. And the first aspect of getting kids motivated is that they have to choose to participate in something. So when we learn what the theory says, is that kids have to be cognitively engaged, they have to choose to be there, they have to choose to participate in what they're doing. Two, they have to invest effort. And as we'll talk about in a few weeks, investing effort means simply in learning, that you have a variety of study skills, a variety of study strategies that you can resort to, and that you choose the proper one and use it. And that's where we invest effort, where we quit a lot of times, where we become demotivated or unmotivated, is when the challenge, when the skill that we selected doesn't work. It's frustrating. If you don't have another tool, another skill, another strategy to draw from, that lets us know that here's a child that does not have a very strong metacognitive awareness. They don't know about how they learn. They can't navigate their way through problems or challenges because they're like a one-trick pony. They've got one tool to choose, and if it doesn't apply in that area, then they're out of luck, which is very frustrating for a child. In addition to that, in order to learn, students must think, which I know sounds almost counterintuitive, but if you go and look at the volume of work that we're asking students to do out there that does not require them to process information, that does not require them to think, it is astronomical. The story I will give you now telling stories every now and then. Is this, I can't see any of you, but I know I'm speaking to quite a few of you. I want you to think back to a class that you had. Let's just say it's social studies for the sake of argument. And the teacher gave you a worksheet. So, you have a worksheet, and the first question in social studies said something to the effect of, the three causes of the Civil War were, and then have three lines. So what you did, and I know I'm speaking to a lot of you out there, which was this, is that you were the day you said the three causes of the Civil War were, and here's what many of you did, you opened up your own chapter, and then you skimmed, you used great study strategy, here's some basic pedagogy, where it is, you're skimming, looking for the three causes, the three causes, the three causes, the three causes, you found it. And then you literally took the cap off your pen and copied verbatim out of the book what it said, and you got an A. There's no thinking involved. There was no processing involved. What that involved was your ability to scan a page, pick up on three words that you had to decode, and then copy onto another piece of paper. Many of you, that's how you went all the way through school. Many kids go through this experience in middle school, high school, and finish school and go to college because they get decent grades. And they get into a school, but they don't have that ability to process them at a higher level. So then what ends up happening is that they get to college, they're asked to think for the first time. In fact, many of you, the first course you took was something called critical thinking. Probably took it your second semester of freshman year. So you got there, you realized you had to think, but you didn't. You were equipped to do it. You didn't have that cognitive awareness to do that. So many kids, I'm not saying you did, but many kids go on probation or flunk out because they don't have the tools to do this. So the student success movement has been so huge for 10 years or so, 15 years. Anyway, the other thing about students wants to ignore the learning is that they have to regulate and monitor their learning. They have to know when you speed up, when can I slow down? Do I want to check for understanding for myself? As a teacher, you all know that you have to check for understanding. How do you do that? You ask a question, you scan the room real quick, you ask another question, you look at their faces, you look at their eyes. Those of you out there are very, very adept at being able to read visual cues, nonverbal cues from kids, and let you know that they're confused. I know that when I have any of you in class, there's a lot of times, especially when you come up and you talk to me about this, where you'll ask me to say, I'm about to raise my hand, but I don't know if my hand raised. How did you go ahead and question? And you can see right on your face that you're confused. These are skills that you have to develop as a teacher. And how do you do that? You have to look, and you actually have to see. We can all look at people, but it doesn't mean we see them. So, anyway, as we go through this, then a huge piece is the teacher role about how we can, how we can put kids in that situation. Denise Maldonado asked us a question. I'm going to try to see if I can come up with an answer here. It says, can metacognition be influenced by beliefs? So I think your ability to develop metacognitive strategies can be developed by your belief on whether or not it's going to work or not. If so, how do you introduce a new learning strategy? Well, let's let me change that question around a little bit. I think what your question really says, or might want to say, is can metacognition be influenced by experiences? And if so, how do you introduce a learning strategy? Because I think that without a doubt, when you ask kids to try something new and they trust you enough to do that and it works, then you can give them that tool a couple of more times and you start to realize, okay, I got X tool and it works for certain situations. Then I think that that's where you really start to empower kids. We've talked about it in other classes. Is that fun in schools? It's not about watching movies on Friday. Fun in schools is being able to solve a hard math problem. I don't care what kids you are. I don't care where you go to school. You go to, I don't care what you look like. Every single kid that solves a problem that they didn't know how to do at the beginning of class instantly is having fun. It might be fleeting. It might just be a momentary lapse of fun, but it's fun because success is empowering. And it's another one of these pieces where when you teach a kid a strategy, and they use it, and it works, and then they can plan to use it, they can monitor the use of it, they can regulate the use of it. So all these words we talked about earlier, that's how metacognition is within the we certainly teach it. So where we are, there are a couple of principles that I wanted to share with you here before we go to break in 15 minutes or so. For helping students learn. And, first of all, some of these who I got about four of them for you is one, is expose kids to different strategies. Just like you're going to be going to student teaching, if you're not student teaching already, if you're in student teaching, when you go in there, it is your time to try a new thing. I mean, what you don't want to do is just teach a lesson that comes straight out of a textbook. I used to go in and have kids read and do a low-level project because you're not really teaching. You're managing, and classroom management is critical, but you want to teach. So one is you need to expose yourself to different strategies to develop your metacognitive awareness as a teacher. You need to expose kids to different strategies, or you get to some of them, but expose kids to different graphic organizers, expose them to different diagrams, and cause and effect charts, and flow charts. If you have a bending tip, if you work with older kids, you should go to inspiration.com. If you work with the older kids, like elementary kids, K-4, K-5, go to kidinspiration.com. And I literally wish I was sponsored by these folks, but you can start thinking it's only a 30-day free trial on those two websites. Because I said free, I should repeat the names of the websites because I don't think it's my attention. One is inspiration.com, just like it sounds, and the other is kidinspiration.com. And you can go and build these cool flow charts and you can teach kids to do this. So expose kids to lots of different strategies. Don't teach them to just rely on the book, but teach them to use the book as a resource. Kids today have several very effective strategies that many of us don't really have yet. And one strategy that kids develop at very rapid pace is their ability to negotiate complex information by searching the internet and searching it effectively. My 11-year-old, when she was 9, was able to go on the internet and find what she needed fairly quickly. I go on the internet and I start thinking about all of these different possible terms to use rather than just being very direct. As my daughter, when she was 9, was in much more concrete operational state than I was. We just type exactly what she wanted right there in front of her, almost every single time. So that's one thing is remember, expose the kids to different strategies, but make sure that they have time to process them. And make sure you talk about the strategies with the kids so they really have a clear understanding about why they're using them. We don't tell kids in school why enough. Two is teach kids about self-regulatory knowledge about how to use their strategies. Last week we talked about procedural knowledge, but we also talked, I believe, about conditional knowledge, which is knowing when to use the specific strategies. So that's another huge part of this conversation, just talk to them about when the appropriate time to rely on certain strategies is appropriate. Three, help students develop the desire to employ their learning strategies as a motivation piece. So there's give them an opportunity to practice those strategies and see what they do with them. If you're going to teach it one day, give them an activity the next day and see how many of them use the strategy. If some of them don't start immediately using it, scaffold that for them. So we need to give them a little help. Four is provide direct instruction regarding metacognitive strategies. Teach them specific strategies. You can go online tonight and look up and find different ways to understand what a metacognitive strategy is. Pick and choose those that work for you. For those of you that still struggle with studying now, and you're stressed out about going through your classes here at Cal State Dominguez Hills, maybe you might need to develop some metacognitive strategies. I just got a couple more things to look at in terms of learning strategies before the break. specific strategies for students that you can teach them? Because I know this can be the next question, which is when you said that beef drawings and stress, but when we get them on 01, which I hope will start to give you some more information based on those questions earlier, but what is it is teach kids processes for deciding what is important. And this may be just at a very basic level, which pieces are important out of a word problem, but also what are important parts from passages of the text, how are they related? That's one piece. Another thing that we do in schools regularly is we teach kids to summarize what is important. How do we represent a larger body of information in a shorter summary? So that's another thing that's very common. You can do that if you have kids, you can do that with your own kids. After you watch a film, they can summarize the main events. And you don't have to sit there and talk to your kids about metacognitive awareness. Trust me, I know many of you are thinking, that's probably what I do with my kids, but they wouldn't stand for that. Another metacognitive strategy is literally underlining and highlighting, because you're selecting important parts of the text. I told this in another class, but I love the fact that so many people, when they go by their used textbooks, that they go and look for books that were previously highlighted. So if this is you, when you were the person that when you bought the book for this course, that you could read critically and carefully every week, somebody out there, you went to the used book section, and you looked for books that were highlighted or underlined, which is great. Because one of the problems with that is you have no idea who had the book before you. So we need to teach kids how to underline. Because my guess is again that if I'm speaking to 110 of you out there, that this is probably going to apply to 30 or 40 of you. Which is if you go back and pick a random textbook from college that you didn't sell back, my guess is that if you underlined, since nobody taught you how to underline, the whole book was almost underlined, or you just underlined the bullet words, which were already bold to stay off the page anyway. So we got to engage the kids in that cognitive awareness, which really is looking at the why and the how of classroom teaching. And then, of course, the big one is taking notes, which a lot of kids are learning this system called Cornell Note Taking. Which is a great system. But remember, that enormous piece of note-taking is not what takes place in the class. It's what takes place after the class. You should teach my sixth graders this thing we should call note-taking and note-making. Because it's one thing to take notes. Let me just background for people who are using their stories. I'm going to try to speak for any of you. If you have a story about this, please call me. I'm just sitting here on this lovely thing. Here's what many of you do. You got to college. You start taking notes feverishly. In fact, you watch note taking in college, they write, you write, and then they shake their hand out, and they keep writing. And it's almost like if you're not taking notes, you're not learning. And I've often talked to people, and I will guarantee there's a very strong correlation inside of people's heads that the more notes you take, the perception of the class is better, is related. But here's the thing, maybe you took notes feverishly, but then you didn't look at them again until the night before the test, and then you A, couldn't read what you wrote, or B, didn't understand why you wrote what you wrote. So you take notes. But the key with students is that the homework that night should be going back and adding to the notes. Whether we're teaching kids to put symbols, whether it's I tried using a little key along the four lost. I tried using little keys to engage with the really important pieces. There are also different tricks and tools. But now you have this wonderful piece called YouTube, where you can go and get some great instructional videos, and you can go on the web and get strategies for note-taking. So let me just really quickly re-summarize those learning strategies that you can teach to children, to do. One is to decide what is important. Two, summarize what was important. Three, was underlining and highlighting. And four, was note taking. So think about how you can teach those to kids in elementary, middle, or high school. These are critical pieces. We talked earlier about strategies. We talked about graphic organizers. We talked already about webs. We talked about Venn diagrams. I saw a great, a fantastic kindergarten by two of my student teachers, Nancy Alvarado and Selena Denton, a fantastic kindergarten lesson where they tell the kids, they represent, hear them say that they were, you know, teaching Venn diagrams. But they literally had these Venn diagrams, I believe, doing less about land and water animals. And then what they would write in the middle was what could go in both. And then and started to hear them go into the word amphibious, which is a little deep for a kindergartner. But they would talk about what goes here, but what goes both. So there's, you know, if you're good, and those are two good student teachers, you can teach some of these strategies to kids, but don't expect them to go home and do Venn diagrams on their own. They're too young. But you can introduce it to them. I told you a little earlier that we're going to touch on mnemonics. But we have mnemonics for reading strategies. The one I believe in the book is READS, R-E-A-D-S, which stands for Review Headings and Subheadings. E is secret bold for these words. A is ask, what do I expect to learn from this? D is do it, read. And three is, S is summarize in your own words. Other mnemonic strategies that some of you might remember would be like SQ3R, which, of course, the whole point of the mnemonic is that you should be able to remember. I think it means something like a survey question, read, review, and not playing on the other one, but so it's reading it. So there are so many different ways that we can teach kids to be cognitively aware. I just want you to start thinking about this. And I am certainly not going to leave the phone call, especially after I beg for somebody to call in. And it is either asthma or asthma. I'm calling from Taurus. How are you, asthma?
Hi, Professor. How are you?
I'm wonderful.
I was telling you about my personal experience about note taking. Really, I'm very good in taking notes, and this will help me later because I'm listening to the professor and I'm taking notes. Now I'm using more sensitive education, I'm hearing, I'm writing. I believe that this will make education better, learning more effective. And I really always encourage my students to, take notes when I'm lecturing or when I'm, doing medicine. And after I go home, I will try to make my notes from the notes that I took in the lecture. And this has really helped me make my learning more effective, I believe.
I think you said two things. One was you said that when you teach, you have your students take notes, and you also said that as a student, you take notes, and you said you encourage your students to take notes, right?
Yeah.
Okay, let me go back and ask you a question. How do you encourage your students to take notes? What's that process like? Do you just tell them that you really should take notes? Is this important, or what does encourage mean? How are you teaching?
I'm encouraging them, sometimes I will include things that they are not in the textbooks, or pay attention, this one is not, it's not in the textbook, you can find this even, sometimes I know I have my lectures or my lessons as PowerPoints, you cannot find these on the PowerPoints, you cannot find these in the book, then I will encourage them now, it is this will be in the test, and it is there in the notes. Then they will, by themselves, they will be very careful, and they want to really take notes. This is one way of encouraging them past or like what I was discussing it now.
Okay. And I think that part of the key though is making sure that your you teach Tuxel.
I'm teaching them now. I'm teaching post-secondary, you know, I'm teaching community college level students. Of course, they are like different, more responsible, but again, if, you know, I have previous experience with high school, with the high school, and with even with intermediate school. If I can, okay, for the intermediate school, it would be different. I will, like, you know, just give them a brief summary about, like, the lecture or the things that I was, you know, interested about. But for high schoolers, no, they will themselves take notes.
You said you teach at a community college now?
Yeah, I'm teaching in Santa Monica College.
Oh, I used to teach at Santa Monica College. What subject do you teach, Beth?
I am teaching physics. I have a major in physics.
You're teaching physics?
Okay.
I smile because I know that's a very, very challenging subject for students because it's so math heavy.
Yes, basically the difficulty, you know, but because my students, they have difficulty in math, right? And then because of that, when you have students that they are really weak in, like, a prerequisite for your course, this will be very, very challenging. And maybe because of that, trying now maybe to have a credential and be maybe a math teacher, so that this will, you know, or a science teacher, because this will, you know, enhance the learning, because I know what are the weaknesses, what the things that they need. I'm teaching also in another university. I'm teaching more adults, like, they are not coming from the high school right away, and I know there is also weaknesses in math, and because of that, you know, it is really more and more challenging in the physics because I need a math that I will not teach, you know. Yes.
Yeah, it's interesting you say that. I appreciate you calling. You know, when I worked at Santa Monica College, I actually worked with I'm 99% sure that Peter Morse teaches physics. I think it was physics 14. And one of the things that we used to talk about was how you not only get students over the fear of taking a class like physics, but how you get them to engage. So I really appreciate you calling us. That's great. So, say hello to the folks in the physics department for me. I don't know if they remember me. But thank you for calling me. So I'm just going to stay right on this camera because we have another caller, and I promise you after this call, we're going to break. So we have Sophia calling from Long Beach. Hi, Sophia.
Hello, Professor. I have a question regarding taking notes. What is the appropriate age students how to take notes? Because I can't remember when I was in elementary. I think I started in fifth grade. But how old they have to be to do that?
You know, I don't know if there's a set age to start, but I can tell you that the fifth grade sounds right. You know, I taught fourth grade, and I tried to have them take notes. It was confusing. I think part of it is because what you're really looking at is it's getting some of those kids to transition from more of a concrete level to a bit of an abstract level. But I think part of it also is, you know, they have to have the cognitive abilities to be able to start picking out what the critical parts are. And what I would suggest to them, instead of teaching fifth grade or even if you're teaching fourth grade, you really want to start doing that at a very, very slow, patient clip. And the reason why I say that is because it's not a natural process to take notes. It's really something we need to learn. So one of the ways that I would do this is, you know, when I used to teach students grade, what I would do is I would do a lecture for maybe 5 minutes to start. And I would give the students notes as I wanted them. This was back when everything was like outline format, where it was like 1, and then A, and then a little A, etc. And I would have the whole thing filled out for them. And then gradually, as we would go through the semester, I would take a line out from a different piece. They have to be listening for it, so when they saw what was supposed to go, I'm sorry, when they heard what was supposed to go in there, they could go and fill that in.
So we get that as a modeling for them, right?
You know, I think that as long, remember what we said earlier, Gustavo actually emailed me, I was waiting for Gustavo's email, he emails me every week. you said you invited about success being empowered. I'll get back to your email later with that. But you know, it's fun to be an elementary school kid and have a teacher come in and say, you know what, when you go to college, not if, but when you go to college, you're going to have to take notes. Your classes are going to be like an hour and a half long, some of them might even be longer. And one way to pay attention and to make sure you don't lose track of where you are is to take notes. And you know what, let's try some other teachers how to take notes. And you know what, to some kids, they'll look at that and say, I don't care. Some kids are going to love the fact that you're treated like a big kid. And you know, there's a really strong possibility that you're going to reach a kid that might not care. And all of a sudden, the fact that their teacher told them, when you go to college, so there's lots of different ways. I know. As long as things are scaffolded, and it's not too confusing for the child, and as long as the teacher's willing to give really meaningful, strong support, I think the elementary school kids can start taking notes. Third grade, no way. Their writing skills aren't strong enough yet. Some of them, maybe you'll have one or two every now and then, but I think you want to be patient. But thank you so much for calling.
Thank you.
I got one more phone call. All right, let's take this phone call really quick. We're going to break. We got a call from Los Angeles. Carl, what's going on?
Based on ancient Chinese scripts, have a strikingly modern appeal.
collection of 20 actual seals and their impressions will be included in this exhibit. Please join us at the University Art Gallery at California State University to make this evening as we look forward to seeing you at our exhibition soon.
Service
places. After we do a day reading of a plan about assimilating into American culture, and Asian immigrants, and I think the form that those four years on campus, I've known for years past, Japanese come into their classrooms, we made scenes, we had workshops where we do like the classes and touring shows are always interesting every year. We do folk tales, we create a folk tale for our own, which is out of the story, passes, and we tour some of the great classrooms. So, what Castro does is only educational theater. It is theater that focuses on social issues, and it has more of a direct purpose for society.
My name is Bart.
Increase your life. Increase your earning potential. Cal State Topeka Sales offers a master's degree in humanities with a focus on the city's world. This master's degree will be earned in this 5 semester evening classes are in your convenience. Call 310-243-3636. That's 310-243-3636. On this job, safety is your first concern. There's a lot that can be wrong. But fortunately, we have Cal State Topeka Sales, the only authorized OSHA training center in the Los Angeles area. If you're in need of OSHA certification, or if safety is one of your concerns, call 888-4LA-OSHA, and you're going to be safe. Remember, safety comes first. Information. There are several types
that we're going to look at. The first about different ways to talk about or different learning items, I'll say, is concept. And all we know about a concept or concept learning is that it basically is a framework of learning, conceptual learning. It's where aspects of a particular object or aspects of a particular problem are characterized. The key is that we use by identifying what we call key defining attributes. And a defining attribute is this: what makes something become a part of one thing and not part of another? So, for example, a defining attribute would be the difference between cat and dogs, and a cat meows, and dogs don't meow. I hope they don't. There are several types of knowledge representations that construct concept learning. One is called a prototype. You've probably all heard of a prototype. In fact, if you've gone to the auto show, you've all seen a prototype, just an ideal representation. And so, sometimes what we end up doing is that when we're going to model something for kids or teach them through a concept learning lesson, is that we're going to tell them what the defining attributes are. For example, let's say that you're giving a lesson on the kidney, and you're going to use a kidney bean, you're going to use some string, you're going to use some cutouts to show how different pieces are heralded. We're building a prototype, so we're able to understand a concept. We can build a prototype of the state of California. I made one when I was a kid that was out of not paper mache, but I forgot what it was called. It was like flower water, and it was wonderful. And I remember doing that because I had to put the Sierras in there, and I remember that it had a little green for the part of the state. And I was fantastic. I loved doing that. I was building a prototype. Then the other way that we learned concept learning is through exemplars, which are examples and actual pieces of thinking or memory. We are trying to teach for concept attainment. And by the way, I looked online for videos on concept attainment, and there are so many that if you just go to YouTube and look up concept attainment, you will have a variety of them. But you have so many of them in 9.5 minutes that I just will be struggling trying to share them with you, so I didn't show them, but feel free to look at them. If your goal of teaching is concept attainment, then what you're hoping is that students will construct an understanding of what you're trying to teach them, the hypothesis, through interaction and through manipulation. And all concept attainment lessons must have four components to them. One is examples. You have to have examples of what it is that you want the students to do to demonstrate that they understand concept that you're trying to have them understand. So one is examples. Two is providing what are called non-examples, what the thing is not. For example, if you were to do a unit on, if we were to do a science unit, we were doing parts of the body, and you were to look at the heart, would be one thing that you were to look at. An example of a heart might be that I would show a fist, because that's the size of the fist, it's roughly the shape, etc. But what I'm not going to show, is a non-example would be a picture, of the Valentine's Day heart, because that's not what it looks like. The other thing that must be included in a concept attainment lesson is the name of what it is that you're looking at having to understand. And the fourth thing is the definition. So the four things that you must have is an example, a non-example, a name, and definition. So think about that. We're trying to have kids understand specific concepts, which is an aspect of a particular object, whether it's a heart, whether it's a donkey, whether it's a bottle of water, whether it's the difference between a pen and a pen. So you come up with examples and non-examples of a pen. Without a doubt, a non-example of a pen is a crayon. So as you go through these things, there's lots of different ways you can represent information so it's meaningful. So one way that you can start to design a concept attainment lesson, and you'll be learning a lot more about this in some of your other methodology classes. But the structure would be to begin, first of all, with really good, strong, solid examples and non-examples. Give them prototypes, give them exemplars, give them effective models so they know what it is that they're going to be replicating. Because what you really want to make sure you do to link this back to PGU is you want to keep them in that concrete box, even if they're high school students, make it very, very concrete for them. So what ends up happening is that when you move into a conceptualization phase, they've got that concrete foundation, so it's an easy transfer for them to make. So those are some pieces to consider. What you want to avoid when you're teaching concept idea is avoid overgeneralization. And that's basically where you're including non-members of the concept, where you're just going a little too broad, and avoid undergeneralization, where you don't include enough of your solution members in the concept. So it's very important to get people appropriate models to operate from. So you're giving them clean examples of what you're asking them to do or asking them for, and then following it up after the concept has been developed by demonstration, by definition. What we want to do is give them a project to work on. Let them replicate it. Let them actually get involved in an implementation phase where they can manipulate the information. Here's a classic example. Go back to Mr. Carl a little while ago. If you're going to teach kids about graphic organizers, show them what it is, show them what it isn't. Tell them what it is, give them the name, and then define it for them. And then after you've gone through and shown them a variety of different samples, you can show them a printed sample. You can show them an online sample. You can do a sample of a graphic organizer on the whiteboard or on the chalkboard. You can show them something on the computer. Then have them go and actually devise their own way of organizing and interact with this art. So we can actually start developing learning strategies with kids. When you get to the word web, you have to make sure that the kids clearly involve and clearly understand the concept that you're trying to get them to learn. Because when you start throwing in modifiers and web and can you give me an example where this is wrong? And let's change to a different area. You have to make sure that the kids understand clearly what it is you're asking them to understand before you start deviating it and making things more complex. Because a lot of times when you make things more complex, the only outcome is that we end up losing things. A couple of other teaching strategies that were covered in this chapter that are really important to touch on here tonight. I know that, and I apologize, the last part we're going to have a fairly quick clip, but I've got several different phone calls that are back and we're supposed to be at break, which I love, don't get me wrong, but I want to make sure that we can cover this information. Discovery learning is where we're actually allowing kids to use their own conclusions regarding concepts based on their experiences. It's where you put kids in situations where they can start to create their own learning by discovering different concepts. Discovery learning, what it really requires is inductive reasoning, inductive generalize, based on specific examples. For example, examples that we give of inductive reasoning, because what we're really trying to do is apply examples from reality to predict the future. And some of the examples we get are the sun rose in the East yesterday and today. When this happened, it's likely to continue in the future. And then doing those first two things, we can predict the sun will rise in the East tomorrow. A couple of other examples to think about might be all swans we've seen have been white, therefore all swans are white. Or all the swans we've seen have been white, therefore the next swan you will see is white. So if you're teaching kids about discovery learning, we're putting kids in certain situations, and then we're leaving a little bit of the unknown for them to make their own generalization. If we remember that the definition of discovery learning really looks at generalization based on specific examples, we can give kids examples. And kids, especially young elementary kids, love to come up with conclusions based on examples. However, when we go the other way, we start getting into deductive reasoning, which is moving from generalizations to specific cases. That's where we get into some types of learning that is referred to as expository learning. And expository learning often involves something called an advanced organizer, which is where we give direction for where we're trying to take the kids to this work, towards learning. What ends up happening a lot of times is that either the teacher will give a lecture, or you will give a worksheet with a lot of the details that are already filled out. And what you will ask them to do is come up with answers, but there are very few opportunities to be incorrect. Of course, some kids will be incorrect regardless, but as we're going through this, that's one thing to consider. Deductive arguments are arguments that claim to provide complete support for a conclusion. In other words, it's an argument whose claim is that if all premises are true, the conclusion must be true. For example, all dogs are mammals. All mammals have kidneys, therefore all dogs have kidneys. We're not trying to get into a class on philosophy, we're going to get into inductive or deductive logic. But we put kids in situations specifically to reach conclusions or to generalize based on what we're trying to get them to learn. Another example of a deductive argument is, since all squares are rectangles, and all rectangles have four sides, what can we conclude? Well, we can conclude that all squares have four sides. So there's lots of different ways that we can get kids engaged in the point of, and you, as the classroom teacher, that's what our choice of teaching, is that you get to be the ones that need to figure out how you want to present it, how you're teaching in an expository method. What you want to do initially is present them with the advanced organizer, because when you present an advanced organizer, it lets kids know where they're trying to go, or at least it gives them some form of a roadmap. The theory on this suggests that we really should not be giving kids over the age, under the age of 10, experiences in expository learning, because we really want to guide them to make their own conclusions rather than going from the general to the specific. So, as we're going through, I just wanted to talk about a few of those pieces, especially expository discovery, learning, and guided discovery, mainly because the next piece that we're going to talk about has to do with problem finding and problem solving. A large part of schoolwork has to do with solving problems, but the problems that I'm speaking of are not like solving a long division problem, but really about trying to take a larger problem, whether it's in the context of something called problem-based learning, which I'm going to show you a video on in about 5 minutes. But it's really about trying to identify if you have a situation. We'll call a problem a situation now, and you need to resolve that situation, or you need to solve that problem. There are several key parts that are engaged with problem solving, which is a very complex process. First, we see, if we remember, is that defining goals and representing the problem appropriately is critical in actually being able to solve the problem. So what you have, you can look at a situation, but unless you know what it is that you're trying to do with that, and you know that problem is conceptualized, then you're not going to be able to solve the problem. So we need to be able to represent the problem. How do we represent that? Give us a problem. One way, concepts, prototypes, exemplars, not examples. We can start to try to figure out what concepts are involved and what it is that we're trying to solve. So what aspects are involved with problem solving? So one is focus the attention. People to solve problems need to be able to focus attention so they can get to the next level, which is understanding the words that are part of the problem. So often, kids do not sit in their head, where what they do is they read and decode the words, and then they try to look back into the question and try to see if they can solve the answer, or worse, is that they just do what I did earlier, which is what were the three causes, and they go right back into the book and just try to find something that remotely resembles what it is, and then they'll write that down because they really have no idea what the problem was about in the first place. So three is first is focus attention. Two is understand the words. Three is after you understand the parts, let's go to a whole. Do you understand the problem? How do all of these relevant pieces and concepts and facts and terms interrelate with each other? And then finally, do we have the knowledge to be able to solve this? Do you have additional relevant knowledge? Do you have the conditional knowledge to be able to solve it? In other words, do you have the appropriate metacognitive development to be able to solve the problem that's in front of you? Many of you, as you know, when you start doing the signature assignment for a student formal does, you read the assignment, you focus your attention, you looked at the keywords that you didn't necessarily understand, which I didn't hear from too many people. Those keywords people called me about and asked them, well, what about the subject? I'm not going to try to pick a kid that's way off the scale behaviorally. What do I do? After you understand some of the keywords, then we can go look at the project as a whole. Then we can go and start seeing what we have already in our knowledge base to start solving this problem. So there is a mnemonic for problem solving, which is called IDEAL, which I believe is in your book, but IDEAL though is IDEAL, and it is identify the problem, define the goals, explore possible strategies, anticipate outcomes, and act, and then look back and learn. So when we're looking at solving problems, the first thing is to identify what the problem is, then know what you're trying to do with the problem, then try to figure out what you have in your toolkit for strategies to solve the problem, and then try to figure out, okay, what am I going to do, and do it. And then after you're done reviewing the task, reflect on the task. A couple of pieces that come into problem solving. Several of you actually asked me some questions about this on email, so I want to try to address these. Some of them have to do with algorithms and heuristics. An algorithm is generally just a step-by-step procedure for finding and implementing a solution. So if you're a math teacher, you give kids algorithms all the time. This is where you don't give you a step-by-step process for how to go ahead and do this. It's nothing that's too complex. In fact, I forgot who said it earlier, but it was the McDonald's piece. Starts to get there. You can give them an algorithm, give them a step. Another piece that we look at is the heuristic. The way to remember a heuristic is it's like a rule of thumb. The definition of it is it's a systematic strategy involved with the problem. But a heuristic is just I'm just blanking on a couple of examples to come up with for you right now. But literally, what it's like a rule of thumb, it's a guiding principle on how you can go ahead and solve things. Other problem solving terms that you want to be familiar with is what is called a means ends analysis, which is that you have to break the larger goals down into sub goals. I usually do this activity, it's called the Wim Hof activity, where we do this in workshops. And then the last is working backwards strategy, which you go over here getting 400, which we often refer to as backwards planning, which is beginning with the end in mind. No, I'm going to go ahead and cut you some here. And you go with the goal and work backwards. So part of solving problems is this world called problem-based learning that Silas Clark once told me to do. I said, San Diego State, I don't know about that, but problem-based learning is where we give kids a problem to work on, and then they have to go and literally solve it. We have real-life, real-time problems. So problems that we give kids in L.A., messing with the Hyperion water treatment plant, how to control all this water, well, a lot of times I enjoy surfing, and I know sometimes when we get heavy rains and can't go in the ocean for a few days because I really love the idea of getting hepatitis. But we can give kids a problem, you know, hey, we have a, you know, if you teach, let's say you teach at a school that's near the beach and you've got a lot of kids that use the beach regularly, you can give them a problem that says, okay, look, we can have X number of tons of waste runoff in them, or dumped into the oceans. This is where it comes from. These are the tools that we have available. How do we solve it? How do we reduce waste 40%? And you have a week to solve it, go. Now we have problem-based learning. So now kids are trying to figure out, okay, what resources do we have? What the idea is that the kids are asking questions and generating their own meaningful learning. Rather than trying to tell you about this, I'm going to show you a video that's just a little over 6 minutes, and it's a very interesting view of working with problems regarding problem-based learning. So I hope you enjoy this. So I'll see you in 6 minutes. Thank you.
Hi, YouTube.
Hi, Sam.
I'm Marshall. And we wanted to tell you a little bit about the cool things that are going on at our high school.
Okay, it seems to be one of our high school. Okay, seems to be one of our high school.
Here our school is largely focused on budgets. These budgets usually start as projects teachers give us.
And as time goes on, any big projects that we think about.
In addition to those, we also have seminars, which are some of the courses are done a little different.
It's a lot
rewarding.
Can you really feel like we're figuring out what we're going to do with Christ?
The talk day, they think it's all fun and games. It's quite the contrary. I think so is what you're thinking. But it can't just be any of you. In order to get my project approved, I need to ensure the Crescent State scans any further information. In my school, we use Project Card. So by place management tool, I'll hold the teachers and students keep things ordered. I'm interested in a cell phone. So I'm a friend of mine. I'd like to research this a little more and see what we can come up with. I first log into Project Card and take a look at what standards I have made. In doing this, I see I need to prepare an informative research paper. I need to look at some 20th century American history. And I need to work on my trigonometry. With this idea and information, we schedule time to talk to our teacher and explore the possibilities. He solved this well. And now we're ready to propose the project. Hey, Laura, what's up? Let's get work.
It's a project for our research, a project for you. Either that or that are planned by answering the questions along with aligning the learning standards we will cover. We also determine our timeline and upload our mind map to create the first project. Lastly, schedule a few solar systems we will take along the way.
It's time for the project to be submitted. Our teacher already knows we submitted the project through Project Found, but we go ahead and remind him anyways. Since our parents can log into Project Found, you can also see what we are proposing and comment on the project themselves. Sometimes, our project goes before the review team, and sometimes the teacher will have a conference with us to answer questions or ask us to change our proposal before he accepts it.
Great news. The project has been accepted.
As we work, we complete a journal entry and log our time to the project. Although we talk to the teacher throughout the process, he can still keep track of our progress through Project Card. Our teacher came up to us and let us know we're submitting English Common History Lesson and not have any information on this specific. So we just did. But what has happened since we started this project? Before we were sending our computer project, we put our final products in Project Found. We also completed a couple of project assessments. And now for our presentation.
Well, what's done is done. At this point, the teacher is going to give you credit, and we want his credit for our students.
My teacher tells me we did a pretty good job. Now that we're back at our houses, we can log on to Project Boundary and see the finished evaluation. We can also see a proposal for graduating. As I complete projects, I simply add them to my portfolio, which is essentially what I've said within Project Boundary that I manage. And can talk about what I've learned and done.
Well, okay, another project for you to do. Welcome.
Alright, so.
Okay, check the mail, that's really getting into a plot. And since it's not what I'm learning from my parents, I'm trying to still tell me tomorrow if I'm going to send it or not. But I think they're going to say, contract. Well, we might order it out of the state. Well, we just have to make a decision.
Obviously, it's not structured a large high school like high schools that we're going to teach at here, but it shows that there's opportunities to get kids to be in charge of their learning. And at the end of the day, it's what you hear from so many people, which is how do you get kids to get motivated to do what it is that they're trying to do? And one way is to get to empower them to engage with their learning. In fact, we talked about that in classroom management the last couple of weeks, which is getting kids to have this autonomous body, and how do you build a collaborative expectation? Well, if the expectations are right there, all you have to do is design a project or identify a problem and then solve the problem that incorporates some of these different state standards. You're really empowering kids to be able to solve problems that are much larger. Now we're going to transition here a little bit. So for the last 8 minutes or so, I want to touch on this notion of creativity. Creativity is obviously a hot button topic for this. As we heard earlier, it's often understood, or it's often perceived, I should say, as something that is reserved for the artist, the musician, the cook. But creativity, may or may not be resorted to that. It actually may be more aligned to a plumber, a handyman. And I'm going to explain as we go along some questions that I have for you about creativity. First of all, is it a subset of intelligence? Is it the same thing as intelligence? Is there a predisposition to creative behavior? What is creative behavior? Well, what Wolfram uses in her book is she discusses creativity as the ability to approach existing concepts in innovative ways, which is great because she sees someone can look at a canvas and it paints something does not necessarily mean that they're creative. Now, my wife, who is very creative, I think, is an amazing artist. But I don't think that her actual ability to put paint on a canvas is what makes her creative. I think one of the things that makes her creative is that she sees novelty, she sees a unique thing to draw. The one lesson I've learned from watching artists over the years, I'm not an artist, is that oftentimes what they'll do is they'll take a picture of something, and then they will shine the picture up on a screen, and then they will take a pencil and use it to identify some of the outline shapes. And then they'll go and they have to figure out what colors go where, how to mix and match colors, the scale, and a lot of other pieces. But I think a lot of people confuse the end result, the fact that you are an artist or you are a musician, as being a part of being creative. What we know, or what I should say, what Wolfolk argues is that it does not necessarily, creativity that is, does not necessarily detract from the forms of intelligence. It can be domain specific. What I really want to share with you, though, is a notion of creativity shared by Robert Stratford. Now, I had a video for you, but the audio on the video was not working. What I'll just tell you is this, is that Bob Stratford, spoken about her intelligence, and the triarchy of her intelligence. There's also a theory on creativity, and his theory on creativity is co-authored with somebody by the name of Duffy Todd Lubar. And what their theory of creativity is called is the investment theory of creativity. And they call it the investment theory of creativity because they draw on very, very, very basic economic principles of buy low, sell high, which is if you're in close stock, you have five stocks, low, sell low, you make your money, etc. But the investment theory of creativity really looks at this, which is can you take an idea that other people don't see the value in or see little value in, and then manipulate that idea so others do see the value in it. According to the investment theory of creativity, and that's a very, very basic piece of this, that's the argument, which is that those people are creative. So I referred earlier to the plumbers. Why because they can look at a novel problem that other people can't see a solution for and generate fixes for. They might be able to come up with alternative solutions to a problem that other people that were just looking at a manual couldn't come up with. That's creativity. Now, I'm not saying that an artist isn't creative, but what I'm trying to argue is that don't just see the kid as drawing, you know, a beautiful little house as the creative kid. It has to do with being able to, for example, salesmanship is an idea of creativity, without a doubt, because you're trying to see if you can demonstrate value to something where people don't necessarily see any more value for it. However, what Wolfram does argue is how we can foster creativity, and what she really says is important, which is one is to provide space for students to develop and to develop their own solutions. With anything having to do with learning, it's important to give kids space. By space, I mean proximal space, physical space, but I also mean time, space to complete something. Sometimes there's too much space, but that's part of the task of teaching, is that the longer you teach, the more that you start to realize that you'll get basic very hard at first. I always try to get through a number of slides within the time that I'm given, and I've got 7 more slides in 6 minutes. So it's hard to get basic, but as you go, you start to modify and change things up. So give kids space, and don't push kids to achieve this traditional assessment means. Give kids alternative ways to do this. This is why I try to let you be creative. And if you want to do the tutor team assignment, great. If you don't come up with something, all you have to do is link your idea to 5 concepts or terms from the course. If you're going to do a PowerPoint on why you're going to be into teaching, I don't care what you write. I want to see that you can link why you're teaching to 5 concepts with that side. If you're going to write a paper on Title IX, great. Link it to 5 concepts from the course. It's the only requirement for that. Types of creativity, according to Wolfram, have to do with one that's called domain relevant skills. These are that certain people are creative in certain areas. Sorry, I'm going to point you. Talents and competencies are relevant to certain domains. For example, you may have people that are amazingly productive in one area, doing dysfunctional in other areas. So are they creative? Well, according to this, yes, they are, because their talents and competencies are domain specific, domain relevant. 2, talents that have a creativity, according to Wolfram, is what she calls creativity relevant processes. These are your work habits, your personality traits, how you see and or look at the world. And then 3rd is called intrinsic task motivation, where you get to intrinsic motivation in a few weeks. So I think that's going to make more sense as we get into it. But people that are intrinsically motivated are more curious. Take on board more and diverse amount of challenges. Trust me, we will get to all of that in a few weeks. To foster creativity, don't just accept one right answer. Allow kids to experience failure and coach them through it. You know, it's one of those things that a student in class asked me a question the other day, and she says, how do you get kids to understand that making mistakes is okay? And the first part is that you have to deconstruct all of their negative experiences with making mistakes in the first place. If the kid had a teacher or multiple teachers over the last number of years that they looked at the world through one right answer, so I'm trying to see you through, through my hand, you only get one small picture. It's important to really make sure that you allow kids to experience failure, because as anybody knows, nobody's ever done anything perfectly or even really right the first time they did it. In fact, we learn, and I hate to say this, but I start to like pay homage to my father here. We learn more from failure than we do from success. That's really indisputable. The takeaways are so much greater. So, create a situation, create an emotional, physical climate where kids feel okay to fail, and then challenge kids to think about things in new ways. Don't accept one wrong answer. The big piece to really think about is, don't push kids too hard. Some kids really are just not necessarily the most creative children in the world. in this moment. I certainly was not the most creative thing in the world. I was told at a young age that I was not a very good artist, and unfortunately, I really clung to it. What I really tried to get through with you this evening is to try to, first and foremost, really try to take a look at some teaching strategies for you. And I really think that we ended up spending a good amount of time on metacognition, which is great, because when I look back over the different courses that we've had over time, metacognition seems to get short shrift a little bit, and it's important for you guys really to take a good comprehensive look at understanding the process of teaching kids about how to learn, and to engage kids in thinking and reflecting on their learning. So as we talk about it, some of my final conclusions, things like this amounts to a couple of them. One is prior knowledge and experiences are enormously influential. 1 minute. I'll just cut back down to the chase. There's an enormously strong correlation between using learning strategies and achievement. As we look forward to the next time that we meet, you have an email that I sent you off that will, yes, there is no meeting this week outside of this, because of the next week, we'll get first of the week off, so just take this week off all your classes, but there's no meeting about next week, 2 weeks you have to come. You are going to email from me about everything coming up. And I hope that what you gained from tonight was a look about how we process our ability to think about how we learn. So other than that, have a great spring break. I'll see you in 2 weeks.